I know all of this looks scary, and I know all of it looks like there's no hope, and it looks like they have absolute control over everything. But in my mind, this is just me as a human, I don't think every single military member is going to fall for that. I mean, they for crying out loud, these people sign up to volunteer their life to defend our country.
Emergency food kit, you'll save 25% if you act now. That's preparewithnatalie.com. Don't wait, do it today.
Muchachos y muchachas. So I know that there is a lot of stuff going on with the military. There's a lot of unprecedented news that we're starting to see. For starters, there was a mandate that was just issued, I think, very recently. There were some talks in doing that, and we've been leading up to this in the coming weeks. But now it's officially official. They are going to mandate the military to take the dirty by September 15th. Now, initially, I talked about this on my Natalie Denise exclusive, so you can go to nataliedenise.com/TV. There are some things that I go into depth about that are not community standards friendly here. So if you're interested in that extra alternative type of commentary and news, you can go to nataliedenise.com/TV, and that's where I talk about it in depth a little bit more. But on one of the videos that I talked about this particular thing about was sort of this commentary that I gave that this was going to be the start of the division in our military. I just don't particularly see every single member of our military members wanting or, I guess, subsiding or bowing down to mandates that are enforced against their will. So I kind of went into my little rants about that. But now I'm learning a little bit more this morning. There was some news posted by the National File that I found very, very concerning, one of which being more so, I want to say it's more CRT leaning. So, you know, we're seeing a lot more indoctrination in our schools and education system where you see these teachers with their agendas and the districts with their agendas. And unfortunately, it's the goal is to indoctrinate children into this more radical way of thinking, segregating each other through race and through cultures and stuff like that. It's specifically the opposite of what they preach. Well, now this is it's reaching our military, and I found this. It was directed from the National File. This is an actual stand down notice to all active commanders right now. And so this is what it basically overviews. Leadership stand down addresses extremism in the force. So I forget the new secretary, the DOD, the new secretary of the defense, but the new guy he's been on it ever since he was sworn into his position. He's been on the whole rampage of getting extremists or white supremacists out of the military. That's his whole initiative. And he's been like that since the get-go. Since January, he's been wanting to eradicate the military off of what he calls extremist behavior. So now it's here. We're here in August, mid-August, and you see here that there is not a command, but it's a notice for a stand down, and this is going out to all the military leaders. So here are some points that I specifically noted here, and I'm going to go over these because these are pretty extreme, even some rewording of our First Amendment, which is really scary. So this is the first point. On February 5th, 2021, the Secretary of Defense directed unit commanders and supervisors at all levels to conduct a leadership stand down within 60 days to address the issues of the extremist ideology in our ranks. So this is exactly what I was talking about. I said it was back in January. It was actually back in February when they were starting all of their CRT indoctrination in our military. The Secretary of Defense actually ordered a stand down and wanted to assess the military for what it was. So basically, in my opinion, this is just me. I'm not saying that this is what it is, but in my opinion, it looks to be that they're trying to eradicate every single America-loving patriot, everything that America initially stands for freedom, for liberty, that's not allowed anymore. That's just my opinion. I'm not saying that that's what it is. It's just what I think it is. So continued, it says, he's giving these ideas of extremist ideologies. Like I just stated, I believe it's the America First patriot type of loving military members. And then let's skip down here to this point. The vast majority of men and women in the United States military and those who serve the Department of Defense as civilian employees perform their duties and responsibilities with integrity and do not disturb racially and ethnically motivated violent extremists, including, it's not a surprise, white supremacists. That has been like the biggest song of the year for this entire regime establishment, white supremacy. So including white supremacists, of course, they're going to zero in on white single males, right? That's like, that's been their whole rant. So of course, this is going to be included in their literature. So white supremacists and the domestic terrorists and anti-government violent extremists. However, recent events shown that we must be more vigilant in our efforts to identify and combat such ideology within the ranks and organizations. Now, what they're talking about there is within recent light of events, they're talking about what I believe, again, I'm just going to tell you what my opinion is. I believe they're talking about January 6th. So within them talking about January 6th, again, what was the common denominator there? It was freedom-loving American patriots. Now, what they were there for, of course, is completely different. I believe that this was a political demand. These were political concerns that we had. And they completely spun this as something completely different. And of course, we'll never hear anything about the riots of last summer, of summer of 2020. We're going to always hear about January 6th. So that's what they're referring to within recent light to those events. As such, we have four goals in the discussion. This is their goal within the stand down of the military. The first is to review the meaning of the oath we each took in becoming a member of the United States military or a Department of Defense civilian employee. Now, as you guys know, if you know anything about the oath, you know, it goes into the, you know, basically surrendering yourself into the duty of protecting and defending the United States from enemies, domestic and foreign. So what they're essentially doing here, in my opinion, is they're trying to spin this. They're trying to reward how we are supposed to be labeled as ourselves. So if you're an American loving patriot and that's who they're going after, well, are they now talking about taking an oath in defending the country against America loving freedom patriots? I'm just wondering, like, that's just a question. I'm not saying that that's what it is. I'm just saying, like, that's what I think that they're trying to do. So the second is to review the impermissible behaviors, those actions prohibited under the applicable law under the DOD military department or military service policy. So I could only imagine that they're already rewriting or rewiring these policies to fit their narrative. So whatever they can fit under that umbrella in order to persecute these, what I believe, patriots, that's what they're gonna do. Point three, we'll spend some time in reviewing the responsibilities for all of us reporting to our chain of command when we observe or learn the prohibited actions or those that cause us concern as signs or potential future problems. So basically they're setting up a snitch system. So, you know, if you're maybe Biden lover in the military, let's not even call it a Biden lover, but let's just say that they're in with the mainstream narrative, right? And they have a fellow patriot, America-loving military member at their side. They're basically setting up the stage to snitch on each other until they rat out each freedom-loving American. Now, that's not even to... even not to scare you guys, but that's not even to tell you what's even coming into the country right now. You're looking at the border, you know, situation, the border activity going on at the southern border, and you see a lot of military age single adult males, or even if they're not single adult males, they're teenagers, they're adolescents, but they are coming into the country single, walking into this country. So if they can't get the patriots to subdue into their own agenda. Well, guess what? There's another effort in which I believe, from my observations, could be their plan B, or it could just be the entire eradication of what they deem to be a problem. So anyways, we'll finish the listening sessions. The secretary wants your feedback on what action we can consider in combating this issue. I want it too. So anyway, that was, it seems to be that they had some sort of military seminar on this entire issue. So continuing, all those service members, this part is really, really chilling. This is where they are trying to redefine the First Amendment. All those service members enjoy the rights of free speech protected by the First Amendment. The unique character of the military community and the military mission requires a balancing of those rights in the importance and the purpose of the military. In fact, the Supreme Court of the United States noted as follows. This court has long recognized that military is by necessity a specialized society separate from civilian society, meaning that this is where they're trying to cite Supreme Court notations or remarks, and they're trying to cause a divisiveness already between the military and civilians. So it says that basically, military personnel, you have a much broader responsibility to act a little bit more, I guess, extra, or be an example for the civilians here. So we have also recognized that the military has, again, by necessity, developed laws and traditions of its own during its long history. The difference between the military and civilian communities result from the fact that its primary business of armies and navies to fight or to be ready to fight wars should the occasion arise. So again, I'm just tying this back to you guys. They're talking about wars. They're talking about the necessity to fight in these occasions or events. But then they're also, when we jump back up to the one that I was talking about, where they're talking about taking the oath, well, they're essentially trying to set the stage to where the oath is meaning something else. So now they're talking about going into wars. They're talking about, the Supreme Court deeming these military members at a behavior that they should be held a little bit hot. Not higher necessarily, but they should be an example to society, basically is what I'm saying. Not in an inferior sense, but they're basically saying, hey, you have a much more broader responsibility to be an example for civilians. So anyways, it continues. The Supreme Court notes, while the members of the military are not excluded from the protection granted by the First Amendment, the different character of the military community and the military mission requires a different application to those protections. The fundamental necessity for obedience and the consequent necessity for imposition of discipline may render permissible within the military that which would be constitutionally impermissible outside of it. The DOD has a compelling interest in preventing the advent and spread. I'm just skipping down a bullet point here. The DOD, the Department of Defense, has a compelling interest in preventing the advent and spread of hate groups and activities within the department. So essentially, again, we're just kind of, let's just dissect this for a little bit. Our over here in civilian life, I guess, if we're, we're talking about normal citizens like us, they're trying to impede this hate speech. Yeah, you have your First Amendment, but you can't do hate speech. Well, define hate speech. They can never define hate speech. Now they're doing the same exact thing in the military. It's saying that the Department of Defense, hey, at the Department of Defense, we have a duty to prevent the spread of hate speech, hate groups, extremists, blah, 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 blah. Well, define that. Well, they won't. They won't. They're going to straw man this argument. They're going to straw man this definition until non-existence, until they get their way. So that's essentially what they're doing. They're trying to eradicate extremists or hate groups from the military. But I can guarantee you, or I can bet you a dollar, they can never concretely define what a hate group or extremist is. So then I'm going to continue and jump down to the bottom. Duty to reject. Service members and DOD civilian employees must reject participation in such activities with regard to service members. Department policy makes clear that commanders have the authority to employ the full range of administrative and disciplinary actions, including involuntary separation, dismissal, and then get this part, I highlighted it in orange for a reason. Even appropriate criminal prosecution against those who actively engage in such activity. Supervisors and leaders of all ranks must also take action to maintain good order and discipline and root out the extremism. You hear that? So it's like, hey, we at the DOD have a duty to not only eradicate these groups out of our military or these individuals out of our military, but also we have a sense of duty to impose some sort of disciplinary measures. And that includes either you're dismissed from the military, you're separated from your members, or they can apply criminal prosecution against our military members. I talked about this, I want to say maybe it was about a month or two ago, where was it? It was a base, I forget the name right now, but there were cadets, basically. I think it was at water, I don't know. I'm not going to try to remember the name of it, but there were cadets, and I believe actually the National File actually broke this story too, but the cadets that were on this base, they were basically being treated like prisoners, and there was a whistleblower that out of anonymity came out to the National File with an exclusive, you know, detail saying, hey, they're treating your military members like absolute prisoners. They are being they pretty much said that they were being in solitary confinement, being put there for 23 hours out of the day because they did not want to get the dirty. So without it being disclosed out in the open, there are already indications that this is actually happening. And they're already labeling this type of, you know, language like anti-vaxxer extremists or anti-maskers. You know, they're starting to label us, as the dangerous extremists in our society, but also the very military members who don't necessarily agree with the mainstream narrative. They're trying to do the same exact thing. So then it goes into the responsibility report. Basically, it is just detailing the responsibility of why you must report your fellow military member. You must report it up the chain of command. All of these points pretty much break that down. So here are just some elaborations on command options regarding service members who obviously are going to probably violate what they're talking about. Depending on the nature of the incident or behavior, commanders have several options when evaluating the most appropriate response given to individual circumstances and consultation with their legal office. These may include counseling and corrective training. What does that sound like? Counseling and corrective training? It sounds like a re-education camp in a way. Removal from certain duties such as restricted area badge access, flying status, or duties involving firearms. So they're essentially going to strip military members of their very important actual duties, their actual skills to defend our country. So essentially what the oath initially meant to do, they're stripping their abilities to do that. Scary. Reclassification, suspension or eligibility to occupy a sensitive position, denial of reenlistment or involuntary separation, adverse re-evaluations and position reassignments, designating off-limit areas, ordering non-participation in specific activities, or removal of appropriate materials. Okay, so that was a lot. I know it was, but that is essentially what our service members are actually facing right now with this new CRT indoctrination in a way to classify them in a different way. Now, this brings me to another subject here. So this one was actually pretty alarming as well. Let me fix my screen really quick. So the Army put out a job notice for internment and resettlement specialist. And they talk a lot about civilian internees. Now, I'm just bringing you this information because I just want transparency. And obviously there's not a lot of transparency out there in the mainstream media. I just saw this as a civilian myself. And I was like, whoa, all right, wait, what is this internment and resettlement? What does this have to do with anything? So this is from the National File. Army National Guard recruits for internment and resettlement specialists. Military documents lay out procedure for civilian internees. And it goes into, they're basically putting out a job description out here. And I'm going to actually take you straight to that description just so you know. And I'm going to actually expand my window just so you see that the URL does reflect that it comes from not a gag website, but from the Army website. Here you go. jobs.nationalguard.com. That's exactly where I'm finding this job posting at. It says 31E, internment/resettlement specialist. Look at the job description here. It says, takes a highly organized individual to ensure day-to-day operations run smoothly in any environment as internment resettlement specialist for the Army National Guard. You will utilize your organizational skills to make this happen in military confinement, correctional, detention, or internment facilities. Interesting, huh? The job duties, supervision of confinement and detention operations, external security of facilities, providing counseling guidance to individual prisoners with rehabilitative program. What? What? Who are you having needing to rehabilitate? And why do you, like, you know what I mean? Like, why does it always seem like it's going to be like a massive number of people for whatever reason? What are you trying to rehabilitate? Maintaining records of prisoners and internees and their programs. And then, you know, it goes into the skills you'll learn, but pretty much the job duty says a lot. So now I'm going to jump back to the National File because there are some particular definitions that I found very, very helpful in trying to break this down. So here it is. Okay. The Department of Defense Directive Number 2310.01E issued on August 19th of 2014 states, subject to the requirements of the law of war and this directive, POWs and unprivileged belligerents may lawfully be detained until a competent authority determines that the conflict has ended or an active hostilities have ceased. And here's the bold part. Civilian internees may lawfully be detained until the reasons that necessitated the civilian's internment no longer exist. What is the scenario for that? You know, I'm just wondering, and I'm not going to give you the answer. I'm just asking a question out loud. What is the scenario for that? If you guys want to answer that, put that in the comments below. But that's just very concerning when I read that. The DoD directive states that the biometric identification information will be collected from all detainees in accordance with the DODD 8521.01E reference I, as soon as practicable, I'm sorry if I mispronounced that, after their capture or transfer to the custody or control of the DOD personnel and will be included in detainee records. BII, or biometric identification information, on detainees who are U.S. citizens or U.S. resident aliens will be conducted in accordance with U.S. law and policy and all applicable DOD regulations, civilian internees, interned, or imperative reasons of security for their protection will be transferred or released when the reasons that necessitated internment no longer exist and a safe and orderly transfer of release is practicable. I think it's practicable. I don't know that word. I'm sorry. A civilian internee, I promise I'm literate, but I just don't know that one word. The civilian internee convicted a criminal offense will be released from punitive confinement when the court administered sentence or confinement ends. So pretty much it's like, you see the job description, you see that they're saying, hey, you know, you're going to be in charge of these internees or the confined people. There's going to be programs of rehabilitation, programs of education. It just, to me, again, just sounds like a re-education camp. And then here, paired up with the directive, it's saying, you know, basically the internee is there until there's reasons to say that they're not there. It was very broad. There's nothing very specific. But basically, I think, and again, this is just my opinion, if there were a scenario in a sci-fi movie where a character was put in a one of these camps or whatever as an internee, it sounds like that person could possibly be a candidate to rehabilitate or re-educate themselves on their behavior and society and what society expects of them. And until they exhibit those characteristics that, oh, they learned their lesson, all right, now you can be released back into the world. That's just me. I'm just thinking, like, if I were a director of a movie and I was directing something, that's how I would direct the movie, right? Like, that's what it sounds like. All right, so finally, I'm just going to give you guys the definitions of what they determine to be a civilian internee. Now, I'm just going to flash here. All of this information, I'm going to link it in my description below. This is the PDF of the internment and resettlement operation. So if you guys want to look through this document, there's 326 pages. I'm not going to go through 326 pages. I'm just going to give you guys cliff notes of what it covers. So in this DOD directive, it says that the civilian internee is defined as any civilian, including any person described by Article 4 of Reference E, who is in custody or control of the DOD during an armed conflict or case of occupation, such as those held for imperative reasons of security or protection. And then here, the definition of a detainee is defined as any individual captured by or transferred by the custody or control of DOD personnel pursuant of the law of war. This does not include persons being held or solely for law enforcement purposes, except where the United States is occupying power, detainees who are U.S. citizens or U.S. resident aliens will continue to enjoy all applicable rights and privileges under U.S. law and DOD regulations. So I'm just going to read this little part here. In the DOD directive, combatant commanders are expected to report to the Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff when capturing, detaining, or accepting custody under the law of war over any person, number one, who may be a U.S. citizen or national, a citizen of a coalition or ally nation, or any individual under the age of 18 years old. So I know that was a big, huge download of information, but all of this just came out today. And I was like, I know I'm on the road. Obviously, I'm on the road, but if you guys couldn't tell by the obvious details in the background, but I just saw this and I was like, this is some big information that nobody is talking about. This actually came out today. And I think these two things paired up with each other, along with the mandate for the military to get the dirty by September 15th. These are my wrap up thoughts here. I know all of this looks scary, and I know all of it looks like there's no hope, and it looks like they have absolute control over everything. But in my mind, this is just me as a human, I don't think every single military member is going to fall for that. I mean, they for crying out loud, these people sign up to volunteer their life to defend our country with the original oath. I don't know what this bull nanny is about, like, you know, look at these domestic terrorists, you know, to protect us from them. I don't know about all that. I'm talking about the original oath to defend this country against enemies, foreign and domestic, and you guys know what oath that is. I don't see every single military member adhering to these spun policies or these spun directives, and you know all of that. I don't believe that every single commander in the military operations adheres to this ideology. So, in my opinion, and again, this is just my personal opinion, I believe that this is very significant in illustrating that we may have a military that is internally divided. We can't see it because they're never going to come out with that. They're never going to come out with that unless there's like an anonymous whistleblower out there that will come out with that information. In which, you know, you guys have to also understand that these military members are still risking their lives in this very communistic, socialistic type of setting or climate that we're entering here. And so what I believe is that every single military member is not, they're not down for this. Okay. So what that will look like, we're only going to have to wait and see. But in my personal opinion, I don't see that every single military member is going to adhere to this. So anyway, I know this is scary. I know. And I know that, you know, I'm not just a bottle of hopium. I'm just being realistic. I don't see where everybody can just adhere to this. I already see that there is some sort of spirit of pushback. I'm not going to say the R word, but, you know, there's a spirit of pushback, and I can only see it increasing, not, you know, being a spirit of complicity. So anyway, those are my wrap up thoughts. I know it's like, okay, here's the doom stuff, but these are my wrap up opinions. I'm being realistic. I don't see everybody adhering to this, especially within the nature of our military. So guys, let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Thank you always for supporting the channel. Thank you for liking, sharing, subscribing, telling somebody about the channel, because I could only imagine that more information like this will continuously come out, and my eyes are always on it. So again, it's always important to spread the message and spread this channel, so that way your people can be informed as well. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in, and I'll catch you guys in the next episode. Say bye.
See you later.